Thank you. It's a great pleasure to be here again. And thank you for coming out on a wet, cold, rainy day to hear me speak about my country. About a country that is waking up, that is moving forward, a country that, according to the new narrative, has shown that it's willing to pact, negotiate, propose reforms and approve them, a country that no longer wants to be hostage to archaic traditions and entrenched practices, a country ready to leave behind the nationalist position about sovereignty, tossing out its heavy ideological baggage, prepared to surmount 15 years of few reforms and little growth, prepared to assume a new national consensus embodied by the Pacto por México, the Pact for Mexico, that became the main characteristic, the trademark of Enrique Peña Nieto's first year. The future is promising, the foreign press says. Mexico has crossed the threshold and has approved reforms that had been politically unpalatable and historically rejected. Mexico has said goodbye to authoritarianism and need not fear its return. The former ruling party, the PRI, has reinvented itself, and so has the country, the optimists insist. Peña Nieto was brought into office by the majority of the electorate and not designated by the dedazo. He has to coexist with a maze of checks and balances, including the Bank of Mexico, the Federal Transparency Institute, the New Telecoms Institute, an increasingly independent Supreme Court. For better or for worse, the government can no longer do whatever it pleases, as it did for many years under dominant party rule. It cannot simply assure that it will win the next presidential elections. And because of that, they say, the PRI has been willing and able to push forward the reforms it promised on the fiscal, telecommunications, energy, judicial, and political front. That's all I have to say about the good. The rest of the talk is about the bad and the ugly. The problem with this argument is that it underestimates the complacency of the political class, the weight of the vested interests that are aligning against the reforms. It underestimates the ties that bind Peña Nieto and how they will tighten as the implementation of reforms takes place. It doesn't give enough weight to the commitments that the president and his party have with the veto centers, poised to sabotage and undermine and dilute the reform process. In order for the process of Peña's Troika that some augur and others would like to see to take place, the president and the PRI would have to unravel the interests that carried him into Los Pinos, the presidential residence. The TV networks, the union gerontocracy, the business monopolies, the corporatist bases of the PRI, all of the accomplices of Mexico's system of crony capitalism that the PRI engendered and is still benefiting from, all of the veto centers that pay lip service to the reforms but are standing up to make sure that they create new cronies instead of dismantling the economic structure that makes them possible. It's true. Mexico today does have a credible narrative for the future. But in order to actually write it, the PRI would have to become what it has never been, a party capable of creating a new paradigm for economic growth and economic inclusiveness and political representation. And at the helm of this, a president that sees the reforms beyond the mere celebration of their approval, who is capable of maintaining the reformist impulse alive despite the pressures to quell it, who goes beyond the photo shoot and the applause and the imagery that has accompanied the reforms and makes sure that their implementation and the elaboration of pending secondary legislation doesn't amount to just window dressing. So let's examine reform by reform, the underpinnings, the implications, what has happened, and what comes next. Begin with fiscal reform. A mini reform, a band-aid, a patch, something that doesn't really solve the substantive problems, but rather seeks to temporarily relieve them. That is the reform that has been approved by the Peña Nieto government. That's the way I believe it should be interpreted. Not as a grand bargain, but as a small intervention. Not as something that is going to revolutionize the relationship of the Mexican taxpayer with the state, but as something that will keep it intact. Not as the renegotiation of the prevailing fiscal pact, but as the continuation of the one that already exists. With the same petrolization, with the same tax evasion, with the same base of captive taxpayers, myself included. The Peña Nieto administration has not sought to change the pre-existing fiscal pact based on low taxation, a lot of public spending, and the use of oil revenues to cover the gaps. He wants to give that pact CPR. And yes, it does hit the business class by reducing certain privileges, like the fiscal consolidation regime. And yes, it does eliminate some preferential regimes. But it is not a reform that contemplates the end of ample spaces for corruption, that entails plugging up the holes, that attempts to depend less on oil revenue or rationalize public spending. And that's why it falls short. That's why it constitutes merely an effort to raise some taxes, not an effort to use them better. That's why it reflects a state that wants to intervene more in the economy without having to spend better or with more transparency. Because what the reform does do is contemplate spending. Spending, keep on spending. It is going to generate permanent pressure on the budget by introducing universal pensions and unemployment insurance. It's going to raise spending over revenues and widen the budget deficit. It's going to leave behind the fiscal discipline that characterized 12 years of National Action Party rule and is disdained by the PRI. We are in the presence of an important expansion of the Mexican state in the economy. We are witnessing how it pushes the limits of its intervention. Without controls, without supervision, without accountability. Because even though the reform does contemplate some mechanisms for the control of spending, like the centralization of payments assigned to the teachers' union once again in the hands of the federal government, in reality there are few padlocks. There is no way of dealing with the budgetary allocations that are growing the most, like the pension payments for public sector employees. There is no way of reducing, in this reform, the way that resources are channeled to political parties. What there is a rise in public spending per se. Net public spending under Peña Nieto will reach historic levels. And the problem is that we don't know if the additional resources will line the pockets of the bureaucrats or go to the construction of highways and schools. We don't know if they will buy another fancy watch for the head of the oil workers union, Carlos Romero de Champs, or if they will lead to the social mobility of those he allegedly represents. Because the reform doesn't seek to resolve the deep-rooted problem of our terrible fiscal pact. It doesn't resolve the dilemmas generated by taxes that are insufficiently collected, by spending that is inefficiently assigned, by public resources that are badly distributed. It doesn't attempt to change the historic dynamic of a state that has little legitimacy to demand more taxes when it spends so badly. If that doesn't change, no tax collection effort will be enough, and Mexican citizens will continue to evade taxes, and business oligarchs will continue to elude their payment, and the government, instead of rewriting the dysfunctional fiscal pact, will continue to place band-aids on it. Moving on to telecommunications reform. Let's see. Before the approval of this much-touted reform last year, there was a lot of responsibility to dole around. Presidents and ministers and regulators and congressmen responsible for allowing that the country's public goods, like spectrum, end up in the hands of the few. Responsible for allowing that two media conglomerates manipulate and blackmail and pressure the political class, as Televisa and TV Azteca do every day. Responsible for cutting up consciences so that they fit the size of the screen. Responsible for creating a fourth estate that frequently acts like the first one, above and beyond representative institutions. A reality that was constructed in the 1950s, was exacerbated during the Salinas period, was institutionalized in the Fox sexenio, and that now the government is trying to change through reforms to the federal communications law. Reforms that seek allegedly to regulate, contain, domesticate, submit the networks to the empire of the law instead of letting them place themselves above it. Promote competition in a sector that badly needs it. Because the last 20 years have been full of unfulfilled promises. 20 years in which the Mexican government has not been able to unleash the potential of a crucial sector due to the monopolies and the duopolies that strangle it. 20 years of weak or captured regulatory authorities that don't seem able to promote the transition from analog to digital television, to open more than two optic fiber threads in the Federal Electricity Commission in order to build an information superhighway capable of competing against Carlos Slim. 20 years in which the government allowed dominant players to avoid competition instead of facing it. And suddenly the shock of the student movement, Yo Soy 132, the public finger pointed at Televisa and Televisión Azteca as manipulative and anti-democratic forces. The election of congressmen and senators who used to work for the networks and were elected to protect their interests. And thus the impulse with which all parties, but particularly the PRD, embraced the need to change the law, take on the pending task, confront the veto centers in the media, and reach an agreement to restructure the underpinnings of media power that has become abusive, immune to competition, a key reason that explains our dysfunctional democracy, given that 98% of Mexicans receive their political information through television. The reforms presuppose that the government will recover the domain over concessioned public goods, that those who exploit them will be subjected to norms and will not be able to act of their own accord as they have been doing. That the president will not just simply give away concessions of spectrum as he did in the past. That the newly created regulatory bodies will have the power to enforce their decisions. That they will have the capacity to impose substantial fines on those who do not fulfill the obligations of their concessions, that the public interest will prevail over the interests of Emilio Azcárraga and Ricardo Salinas Pliego. But that doesn't mean at all that the war has been won. On the contrary, the television networks are poised to dilute, veto, block, and use any weapon in their arsenal to make sure that the reforms don't touch them. They have already achieved the postponement of the elaboration of secondary legislation, the date passed for that without any consequence. They are trying to make sure that must carry, must offer doesn't happen. And although the new regulatory body, the IFETEL, has the capacity to fine, open up licitations of spectrum, declare the existence of dominant players, and regulate interconnection fees, Its role is currently limited by the non-existence of new rules that the Congress should have created but hasn't done so. Because congressmen are too busy slicing up the budget and opening up the oil sector, because they haven't understood that the telecoms battle is the right battle at the right time against the right enemy. And instead of waging it, they are wondering how to declare a truce even before the battle begins. Moving on to energy reform. The government seems willing to compromise the content and implementation of other reforms in order to assure the passage of the one that it really wanted all along, the one it hopes will be the catalyst for growth, the one that will cement the changing international narrative about Mexico, energy reform. And its importance, given the diagnosis recently published by the Mexican Competitiveness Institute, a study that does make clear, that does exhibit the costs of falling behind, the costs of maintaining the status quo in the oil sector for so many years, the costs of staying at the margins of a global energy reform that Mexico has not been a part of. We've been stuck in the same place for more than a decade, according to the Competitiveness Index, because we haven't created the conditions for the economy to take off. And oil is a big part of the map that has led us nowhere. In the last 30 years, the proven reserves of crude have grown 2.5%. And as the study reveals, the paradigm about the end of the oil era is false. It has, regrettably, and will continue to be the main source of energy in the years to come. And what is increasingly evident is the difficulty to find and exploit those new resources. We are transitioning from the era of easy oil to the era of hard oil. And only the countries with the capacity to develop cutting-edge technology and deal with this new environment will be able to take advantage of it. But in Mexico, for decades, we've been wasting our potential, wasting our time, channeling more resources into the pockets of Carlos Romero de Champs than to the vast majority of Mexicans, channeling resources from Pemex to the government that it should have obtained through taxes. We needed an energy reform that did not privatize oil, but did allow for strategic associations and the liberalization of energy markets. We needed an energy production levels, allowing the cannibalization of Pemex by union leaders and private contractors and government officials and all of those who finance corruption through black gold. So Mexico did need to eliminate the constitutional monopoly in exploration and perforation. It did need to transform Pemex into a real business, run with transparency and accountability. It did need to promote private investment in refinery, transportation, and distribution of oil, so as to not keep on perpetuating the myth that oil belongs to the Mexican people, when in reality it has belonged to the few who siphon off its wealth for private gain. So how has the reform that was approved addressed these issues? I think incompletely and dangerously. And it's in this context that I'd like to reflect on what for many became the silver bullet, the most obvious solution to complex problems, the only weapon that, according to legends and folklore, can slay beasts and werewolves, the weapon of choice of those who believe that private investment in Pemex is the only way to address the problems of productivity, efficiency, corruption, corporatism. And in an effort to break the stranglehold, run the risk of repeating the same mistakes of the past and leaving the real beast alive, the structure of Mexico's crony capitalism and the true evils it has engendered. Too many politicians and analysts and investors have celebrated energy reform because they are centering their gaze on an easy target. They recommend silver bullets against the oil workers' union and close their eyes when faced with the fact that this reform doesn't touch the union's privileges. They excoriate the rapacity of public monopolies without taking into account weak regulation that explains the same rapacity in private monopolies. They view private investment as a panacea without understanding that if the rules of its participation don't change, the alleged cure will be worse than the disease. The silver bullet that is being put into the gun will not bring the promised benefits, but rather renewed opportunities for other cronies, in this case, the ones close to Peña Nieto and his administration. What Mexico didn't think through was how to modernize the energy sector without just passing on to private hands the wealth it produces. How to extract oil without simply transferring its gains into private hands. How to strengthen Pemex's financial structure without simply creating conditions for more concentration of wealth. How to promote investment in a key sector while distributing the gains for development. Mexico has not answered these questions well, and thus runs the risk of repeating past mistakes. None of what was approved in terms of promoting private investment is intrinsically bad in and of itself. And taken together, some of these reforms form part of an undeniable diagnosis. The energy sector needed resources, and it became necessary to obtain them from somewhere, given that the finance ministry was unwilling to sacrifice the resources that Pemex provides to the government and its clientels. The problem lies in what wasn't contemplated, in what wasn't proposed, in what wasn't part of the limited debate on this issue. Something that the political and business class eludes, the promotion of competition, the need for strong regulation, the protection for consumers, the imperative of the public interest regarding oil and its future. Measures that countries like the UK and New Zealand and the state of Texas implemented when they privatized their energy companies under the supervision of efficient and powerful regulatory enterprises capable of setting clear rules among new players. That which would have been necessary to transform the country's economic horizon through the construction of energy markets that benefit Mexico's citizens and consumers, and not just the private companies that pressured the government to open up the oil sector with the objective of extracting more rents from there, too. Let's just think back to the privatizations that took place during the Salinas period in the late 80s and early 90s to understand the magnitude of the mistakes that were made, the depth of the changes required. As my favorite World Bank report entitled Democratic Governability in Mexico Beyond Social Polarization and the Capture of the State argues, the Salinas reforms sought the same objective that the Peña Nieto reforms are seeking today: promote economic efficiency, augment fiscal revenues, attract foreign investment, promote competition, create functional markets. But in many cases, like banking and transportation and telecommunications, the reforms only produced greater market concentration and less competitiveness in the economy. Privatizations only entailed transferring rent-seeking by the state to rent-seeking by the private sector. They were processes that were friendly to elites and harmful to consumers. And the same thing may happen in the energy sector if the government keeps on believing that private investment is the silver bullet. The ills that Mexico faces are more complex, and it won't be possible to confront them with one single type of weapon. Despite the reforms, the beast of crony capitalism survives due to the absence of regulatory agencies, strong, autonomous, independent, that can contain those who've been able to establish dominant positions in one sector after another. the beast of oligopolistic capitalism survives thanks to a way of governing Mexico in which the vested interests have been able to guide public policy in a way that protects their interests. And that's why energy reform will not be a sign of progress until the regulatory conditions that accompany it improve. So, up to now in this presentation, I focused on the good, the reformist impetus, the bad, the specifics of several reforms and their implications. I'd like to speak now about the ugly, what Reforma newspaper calls the ejecutómetro, a monthly measurement of the number of executions that take place in Mexico. It reveals that the same number of executions that occurred in the first 100 days of Peña Nieto as took place in the last 100 days of Felipe Calderón. The numbers about criminality in Mexico are among the worst in the Western Hemisphere. And according to Latino Barometro, over 40% of Mexicans say that either them or a family member has been the victim of violence. Insecurity, according to a study by JP Morgan, shaves off 1% of the country's GDP on an annual basis. The new Mexican miracle has yet to reach the highways of Michoacán or the streets of Acapulco, because violence and insecurity persist, even though the conversation about them has changed. Impunity continues, although no one in the government wants to talk about it. And there is much to talk about, given the approval just last week of a national code for penal procedures, a code we should applaud and lament. Applaud for the fact that it introduces oral adversarial trials in a country that needed them, but lament because it deals with what happens in the courts, but does not regulate the police, leading to people who are apprehended and then tortured, interrogation procedures that are not standardized or supervised, policemen who are badly trained, processes for obtaining eyewitness testimony that do not follow best international practices. So Mexico will have clear rules for judges, but not for policemen. And in places like Michoacán, the police are the problem. The courts are the problem. The absence of the rule of law is the problem. In the plazas and the streets, in Apatzingán and Zitácuaro and Morelia and Tierra Caliente, signs of the emergence of a parallel state, signs of a microcosm of what happens elsewhere throughout the country, in places where the government doesn't govern, but rather la familia or the caballeros templarios do, where the norm isn't the law, but rather the expression plata o plomo, silver or lead, where instead of calling the police in search of protection, people prefer a cartel or a criminal group to do so, where self-defense groups have burgeoned in the absence of a state that cannot carry out its most foundational task, the monopoly of violence. Story after story of kidnappings, extortion, torture, theft, corruption, and the simple act of walking out on the street. Story after story of what it means to live in a violence-riddled municipality, in a captured state, under the control of parallel forces that have become, as a teacher in Zitácuaro laments, a second law. Despite the 50,000 soldiers on the streets, despite the 20,000 federal police on the highways, despite the over 60,000 dead due to drug-related violence in the last 6 years, criminal syndicates grow and control, decide and diversify. The democratic transition brought the end to the Pax Mafiosa that the PRI had established with organized crime. The arrival of an albeit imperfect democracy has entailed the end of old accords and the beginning of new rivalries and new infighting that not even Peña Nieto can control. And because of that vacuum that organized crime can fill in the face of the impotence and the incapacity of the government, whether it be federal, state, or municipal, organized crime begins to fill the deficiencies of the state. When citizens don't believe in the police or in courts, criminals or self-defense groups fill that role. When the state cannot assure security or employment or avenues for social mobility, cartels begin to do so. And that is the challenge for Mexico. A war less centered on the apprehension of drug kingpins and more on the seizure of their money. A war less centered on killing capos and more on creating functional courts. An effort that would require not just using the army as a deterrent and a peacekeeper in places like Michoacán, but also a financial strategy to confiscate accounts and a political crusade to combat corruption wherever it may lie, in the courts, and then in the municipal presidencies, and in the governorships, and in every corridor of power in Mexico. So throughout this journey that I have asked you to take with me this evening, there is one constant recurring theme: the persistence under the new PRI of the old veto centers, the capacity of certain groups to stall or block public policies geared towards the public interest. And in the face of them stands a weak society, an oftentimes captured state, in a state that cannot even create the peace in places like Michoacán. A government incapable of dismantling the web of privileges that has strangled the country for so long. Now, many of us believed that the transition to democracy would bring with it a reformist effort geared towards that purpose: contain, regulate, compete, grow. We were wrong. Now, under the PRI, we are beginning to see reforms that did not occur before, but the array of opposing forces should not be underestimated. Many are still beneficiaries of the status quo, and few have incentive to sustain a reform-oriented coalition. Think of the rapacious public sector unions, untouched. The businessmen entrenched in monopolized sectors, untouched. The corporatist campesino organizations taking advantage of subsidies like Procampo, untouched. The obese and unproductive bureaucracy comfortably installed in the public sector, untouched. Dominant actors that behave according to the corporatist, clientelist logic of the past and thus sabotage the future. Accustomed to defending privileges instead of accumulating merits, accustomed to extracting rents instead of competing to lower them. And this extractive, rent-seeking, exclusionary system, so well described by Darren Acemoglu and James Robinson in Why Nations Fail, is perpetuated by political parties that defend their own fiefdom, their own cartload of public money. According to Duverger, in the same way that men can serve throughout their life the footprints of their childhood, political parties suffer the fate of their origins. And that is why the PRI as a way of life persists. That's why it demonstrates selective tolerance towards impunity. And we only have to recall the case of Arturo Montiel, who has kidnapped his children in a clear violation of the Hague Convention against the abduction of minors, with the full support of the Peña Nieto administration. That's why the PRI insists on the illegal practice of using social programs to buy votes. That's why it insists on spending without being accountable for doing so. And yes, in the face of that, there is the new. Basically urban electorate with a growing capacity for communication through the social media. A population that is young, that can organize itself politically, as Yo Soy 132 underscored. A society that is learning how to resist and denounce and demand, that is learning how to criticize our authoritarian inheritance, that is learning to fear the return of recycled authoritarianism, that doesn't want to backtrack on what we've been able to move forward, that is not willing to simply receive the PRI with open arms. And the fears of that return, a return to the past, are not unfounded. Political plurality in the states has become smaller, given that the PRI is at the helm of 20 of the 32 entities of the country. And although El Bester Gordillo was jailed, old union corporatism remains intact, as I suggested earlier, evidenced by an energy reform that, as Peña Nieto suggested, will not affect the rights of workers. And in Pemex, those rights entail the capacity of a worker to simply give his post once he retires to a member of his family. The sanction to corrupt individuals has not occurred. And the recent exoneration of Raúl Salinas de Gortari suggests that that will not happen. Alternancia in power among political parties has served, as Lorenzo Meyer argues in his book, Authoritarian Democracy, to naturalize and normalize old practices in new government officials. And therein, the disillusionment, according to a survey carried out throughout Latin America between 2010 and 2011, citizen support for democracy fell by 9%, and only 40% of those who were surveyed reinforced their preference for democracy. Only Honduras and Guatemala had a worse result than Mexico did. We have serious difficulties with our democracy. We have parties that are very well financed and not at all representative. We have anti-democratic forms of exercising power and using public money that persist despite years of citizen demands trying to reduce public financing to political parties by 50%. We have a judicial and penal system that keeps on jailing innocents while it exonerates the guilty. And the worst thing is that we have become accustomed to this being the case, the accepted and tolerated dysfunctionality. We believe that unbound privileges and excessive rent seeking and the absent or intermittent rule of law are an unchangeable part of our national identity. We don't understand that the entrenchment of the clientelist, corporatist, rent-seeking logic in Mexico is greater than in other countries, and it's a defining reason of why it is so hard to grow and to change and to prosper. And I believe this is an unacceptable situation. It leaves us out of the fold of rapidly growing emerging economies. It condemns 50 million Mexicans to live in a rich country that is poor and unsafe for them. It makes us incapable of promoting investment, competition, equal opportunities, and social mobility for the many. We insist on being exceptional, a unique country in so many ways. Exceptional insofar as the permanence of so many privileges in the hands of the few. Unique insofar as the social tolerance to this fact. And therefore, the real solution for Mexico does not lie only in the implementation of reforms from above. Real hope lies in the creation of a context of greater demands from below, with the emergence of citizens who fight for rights, and not just for government distribution of the spoils. Those who, to paraphrase Eleanor Roosevelt, would rather light a candle than complain in the dark. Those who continue to believe in Mexico's capacity to change, despite evidence to the contrary, our wide, beautiful country. A place described by Efraín Huerta in his poem, High Treason, of rivers and fields sick with poppies and mountains spiked with magueyes. I think about our future, a grain of wheat, the ample Mexican heart of stone and air. And that makes many people like me believe in patriotism, in social justice, in creative indignation, in participation, in service, in individual rights, in what goes beyond the cynicism of cynical, cold men with eyes of bisontle and granite, like Emilio Gamboa and Mario Marín and Arturo Montiel and Manlio Fabio Beltrones. Vis-a-vis them, I think of the daily decisions of extraordinary Mexicans I know who jump and move and act, and I'm sure there are many of them sitting here, paralyzing the mediocre noise of the streets, calling attention to what ails us, voices of hope, of progress, voices to fight against fear, corruption, impunity, abuse, the arbitrary use of power, the stream of fatigues. Voices with which to understand that the real awakening of Mexico lies not just in legislative reforms that can be touted in the foreign press. It entails the dismantling of what remains of the old authoritarian system and the beginning of a new code of citizen conduct. A united front against the return of some of the worst vices of our past under the new PRI. A citizen coalition so that our eyes don't remain wide shut. The task is Herculean, and it involves us all, every person sitting in this room who cares about Mexico. As for me, I was last here 2.5 years ago, and here I am again, ready to work with more determination than ever in the only place I know, with words, and affiliated to the only party I belong to, ours. Perhaps today I'm being a bit of a romantic, but I think of Mexico, and I think of more than the good, the bad, and the ugly. I think about my daughter Julia's wild, curly Mexican hair, the nostalgia for Carlos Fuentes and Carlos Monsiváis and Germán Dehesa, who left such a good mark behind them. The growing urgency that I and many feel for justice and dignity for all. I think of Mexico, and I think of the sun going down on the waves of the sea in San Pancho, a minuscule town north of Punta Mita. I think of the sound of the organ grinder walking down the streets of the Condesa, the majesty and the mystery of the intricate ruins in Mitla. Every meal I've ever had at Dulce Patria, or simply riding on a bike down Paseo de la Reforma amidst the boisterous crowds on a Sunday morning. I think about the risk of losing our home, like those who have suffered that fate due to the omnipresent violence in Michoacán, and the opportunity of recovering it, of achieving what Rosario Castellanos wanted, that justice be felt among us. It is exciting to be a Mexican in these times, even if one does have to coexist with the return of the PRI. I am grateful for that grace. I don't believe we are unchangeable. I don't believe we are unmovable. I don't believe we are inferior to others or we deserve any less. We are from the most transparent region of the air. Fortunately, we are from Mexico. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. And I'm told that we have time for a Q&A, so if you'd like to raise your hand, stand up, and tell me who you are, and we'll begin a conversation. I think there's a microphone that's being passed around.
Buenas tardes. My name is Miguel Guerrero. I am from Michoacán. I'm also a radio host at KPFA Radio. And I would like you, Denise, you could, to address on the first part of your speech tonight about the good. Mm-hmm. When you mentioned Peña Nieto won by a majority of vote, mm-hmm. to address the circumstances, here comes to my mind the biggest scandal of the Soriana cards, among other things. So I consider pertinent to clarify how he won. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
I am also indignant by the fact that the case of Soriana, and specifically Monix, was simply set to rest by the Federal Electoral Institute in what was a highly irregular vote by the Consejo General, which included the vote at the very last minute of Sergio García Ramírez, who had recused himself, because he was close to the owners of Monix. He decided to vote. They let him vote. That vote led to the exoneration of irregularities committed by the PRI in the election. And the next day, he resigned from his post, which raised many eyebrows, as it should have. The problem with the Mexican electoral system is that it generates incentives for parties to break the law, to find holes in the COFIPE, to do everything they have to in order to win, knowing that if eventually they get caught, they might be sanctioned or they might not, but they've won the presidency anyway. So in the case of this election, I believe, as you do, that there were irregularities, but we have an electoral system that cannot prevent those irregularities or sanction them afterwards. We have elections that are increasingly expensive, that are increasingly media-driven. I think another factor that contributed clearly to Peña Nieto's victory was the fact that he had become a brand years before the presidential election had taken place. And that brand was constructed by Televisa. I mean, they even found him a wife. So I could go on and on about the conditions that you've spoken of that led to an election which he won. But think about the context in which he won, a context that did not necessarily entail a level playing field. Next question. Yes.
Buenas noches. My question is, there is in Salinas govern, when Salinas governed in Mexico, there was this ZLN.
This what, perdón?
The ZLN that come up in Chiapas, and then right now we have these self-defense groups. What do you think is the difference? That is the first question. The second question is, what do you think is going to happen with them, with these groups?
I think the EZLN and the self-defense groups are very different. In the EZLN, and I remember that time vividly, January 1994, the first day of the implementation of NAFTA. And the EZLN was an indigenous movement led by Subcomandante Marcos that became a voice for the dispossessed, for indigenous groups that had been marginalized, that questioned the quality of Mexico's so-called democracy, which was non-existent at the time, and which shook the consciences of many Mexicans regarding marginality, poverty, the role that indigenous people play and how they had become invisible to Mexican society. And that was, it resonated among many Mexicans, and for many months, It became the center of our national public debate. And then Colosio was assassinated, and the economic crisis occurred, and the EZLN faded from the public eye and became a small group that really had very little resonance, and that had no lasting effect, really, in terms of our public policy towards the indigenous people or a fundamental change in social policy vis-a-vis combating extreme poverty. Whereas self-defense groups, I think, are a very, very different, how do you say, kettle of fish? I think those self-defense groups that have started emerging respond to a very natural need, and that is of families to protect themselves in the faced with the incapacity of the government to do so. And I'm not legitimizing their existence, but I am trying to understand and explain it. As Mireles has said, I mean, if I'm told that my daughters are going to be kidnapped and the police and the army cannot make sure that that does not happen, who wouldn't raise their hands or use every weapon at their disposal, and I'm arguing here metaphorically, to protect their family? And I think that's what's happening in Michoacán, as I argued in my presentation. And I really have nothing innovative or new to say here. It's the absence of the state. It is the absence of functional police. It is the absence of real courts. It's the absence of the rule of law. It's remember what Hobbes described in Leviathan, what life was like before the existence of the state: nasty, brutish, and short. And that is what life has become for many people in Michoacán today.
Could you elaborate a bit more about the student movement? Do they have, are they active? Do they have broad support in the society? Or are there other movements like the student movement that, where there is some hopeful sign?
Well, unfortunately, Yo Soy 132 had a brief life.
Why?
Well, many of my students were leaders in Yo Soy 132, including Antonio Atolini, who became the dominant media presence at the time. I marched with them. I wrote my pancarta, Voto Mata Copete. And we all believed that this was a watershed, what Malcolm Gladwell called a tipping point in terms of mobilization from below. But what began to happen? Well, after their initial success, all of the universities aligned in Yo Soy 132 started having assemblies to decide what to do. And every university had one vote, except for UNAM, that voted by faculty. And UNAM has many faculties. So what happened in the asambleismo that eventually ate the student movement up? Well, that the voices, the more radical voices of the UNAM students, took over. And they started incorporating many demands that had nothing to do with the foundational idea that motivated Yo Soy 132, which was the democratization of the media. And I think that that was the key cause, the banner that they should have held up, the only banner, because it did have public support. But insofar as the movement began to incorporate more and more demands, the liberation of political prisoners from Atenco, not that they don't deserve to be liberated, but the movement became a multiplicity of things for a multiplicity of people. So that was one factor that I think led to its demise. But the nail in the coffin of Yo Soy 132 was what happened on December 1st, the day that Peña Nieto took office. And I actually happened to be there on Avenida Juarez because I was taking my students to the Museum of Tolerance. And we saw what happened. We saw how these groups of young men with masks and chains started looting stores and trashing restaurants and breaking windows, while the students and ordinary citizens who had nothing to do with the violence that was occurring ran for their lives. And there was the police capturing the wrong people and then blaming what had happened on the students. And many of those who were part of Yo Soy 132 came from private universities. They were, you know, the privileged sons and daughters of the upper Mexican middle class. What parent of a son or daughter of the upper Mexican middle class was going to allow them to continue to march in a movement that was associated with such violence and destruction? And it wasn't them who initiated the violence and destruction. To this day, we do not know who paid those people with masks and chains to go and loot and discredit the movement that has not been able to recuperate from that blow to this day. And I'd say that is a very unfortunate fact, because so many of our hopes were placed on what we saw as the Mexican Spring.
Buenas tardes, profesora, audiencia. My name is Ernesto Cinega. I am from Guadalajara. I am a student here at Berkeley. I want to know, what are your thoughts about the detention of El Bester Gordillo by the government of Enrique Peña Nieto?
I think she deserved to be imprisoned. For many reasons. She deserved to be imprisoned for corruption, for abuse of power, for siphoning off public resources to pay for her her grand, lavish lifestyle. At the same time, she's not the only one. And there's a long list of people exactly like her. But I think what Peña Nieto tried to do, which was very astute politically, was to imprison her, and then he didn't have to imprison anyone else. He sent the message of discipline within the ruling party. And since that day, anyone who might have raised their voice against energy reform or any other of the reforms that go against nacionalismo revolucionario, they have remained silent. Beatriz Paredes, who I anticipated would be the vociferous voice against energy reform, was shipped off to become ambassador to Brazil. And you've seen extraordinary discipline within the ranks of the PRI, including some of the its most nationalistic leaders, who have basically zipped up and closed their mouths and remained silent because they now know what Peña Nieto is willing to do, which is put the justice system at the service of political crusades run by the president. You know, I do not support El Bester Gordillo, yet the way in which many of the things that happened during her apprehension do constitute a violation of due process. Mm-hmm. And it's important that we underscore that. Regardless of how I feel personally towards her, so that this does not happen again, because it happens time and again. We saw it with Florence Cassés, the discretionary use of the judicial apparatus by a political system that still tolerates that discretionality. Yeah, back there.
Mm-hmm. Hello. Hello. I am Manuel. I'm a student here in Berkeley. I'm from Zacatecas. And I wanted to ask you if you believe there are so few good things happening in Mexico as to deserve a few minutes from an hour-long lecture.
Well, I tried to balance that at the end with everything that I love about my country. And I don't know how much time you have, but I could go on and on. I only saved a paragraph for the good things, but they have nothing to do with public policy. They have everything to do with the hope that I place in citizens and activists and my students. My hopes are no longer placed in the political class because maybe I've been doing this for too long. or maybe I remember Salinismo too vividly, and that's why I'm so suspicious about what's been going on, because it so resembles what we saw back then. The new narrative, the accolades by the international press, Salinas and his cabinet on the cover of Newsweek being touted as the best economic team in the world, which later led people to ask after the financial crisis of 1994, why would such smart men make such stupid mistakes? I remember the energy, the vibrancy, the sense of purpose that accompanied Salinas, how in the US Congress he was referred to as one of us. And I've lived as a citizen and as a consumer through processes of reform that ended up hurting us. And you see that every day if you use the Mexican banking system. You see that every day if you drive down highways that were privatized, including the infamous Carretera del Sol. You live that every day if you try to use internet in Mexico and end up paying for a speed and a service that is not provided to you. I could go on and on about the ills of crony capitalism constructed by Carlos Salinas, and we're still trying to deal with the effects of that. Many of the obstacles and veto centers that I described were built by that process of reform. Carlos Slim is a creature of the state. He was created by the way in which Telmex was privatized, with no regulation, with no clear rules for competition, with protection for him up until this day. So I think it's good to be suspicious as an analyst. It provides an effective counterweight to the cheering and the applause in Mexico. And not so much in Mexico, because if you look at the polls, many people feel exactly like I do. And Salinas and Peña Nieto's popularity is not that high. People are still waiting to see the effects of the reforms, and I think those effects should not be measured by how many front page glowing articles about him we read in the Financial Times, but by the effects of these reforms on citizens and consumers. And for me, telecoms reform will be a triumph the day that my internet service actually provides the speed that it promises in its contract. The day that my cellular telephony bill is comparable to what you are paying here in Berkeley. And education reform will be a success when Mexico's visa evaluations begin to climb instead of remaining stuck at the bottom. And energy reform will be a success if and when the monthly bill I get from the Comisión Federal de Electricidad is comparable to what you pay here, and on and on and on. Maybe my standards are high. They're the standards of a Democrat. They're the standards of a social Democrat, someone who believes in markets and state intervention. They're the standards of those who of someone who believes, why should we settle for less? And if that critique is bothersome or seems pessimistic, I'd rather live in the world of creative indignation than in the world of cheering on a presidency that still has a lot to prove.
Thank you. Well, I mean, Mr. Camacho, I had the privilege to take two classes with you, which was awesome. First of all, I want to say, in defense of my thesis, I think the internet connection here can be even slower. What I wanted to ask you is something that I remember very well from my classes and that inspired me was about civil participation to change things, right? But my only problem is that sometimes I think, in general, the public is only looking at the immediate things that are bothersome to them. So how can you make this something constructive, like people organizing to demand lower salaries for judges who are making like $50,000 a year, like a month, sorry, $50,000 a month, to modernize like the judicial system, to change all these things that are, how do you mobilize the young people in Mexico to create something constructive?
Well, you choose a cause, and then you try to motivate people to follow you. And I'll just tell you a personal anecdote. In December, my internet service went down. And for 3 days, I called up Teléfonos de México to send someone to please fix it. And nothing happened, despite 20 minutes of sitting on the phone, waiting for someone to answer. And at the end of 3 days, given my profession, I desperately need the internet, I was so angry that I tweeted, arroba Telmex soluciona, I haven't had internet in 3 days, here's my my número de queja, and what are you waiting for? Do you want another critical article about Carlos Slim? Which I admit perhaps was not appropriate. And so this created a furor in Twitter land. It became a trending topic. And half the people who tweeted lambasted me for using my privileged position as a columnist to attack one of the founding fathers. And and the other half of people, and the critics baptized me Lady Telmex. And the other and half of the people who tweeted were very much in favor of what I had to say because they had a sense of humor and bad internet. So on the basis of what happened, I decided to do something constructive. So with the help of a friend who knows how to do surveys, we did a survey. We put together a survey on SurveyMonkey, and I tweeted to my followers to please complete the survey, which had all sorts of questions about, it asked them to measure the speed of their internet, to tell me who their provider was, to say if the service had gone down, had they been reimbursed, and to ask them if they were willing to participate in a class action lawsuit. So over the course of 24 hours, 2,600 people responded to my request. And they actually filled out the survey, which took 30 to 40 minutes. They took it very seriously. And on the basis of that, I was able to write a column that had very interesting information that we already know, but it was good to see it there in black and white. 60% of users are paying for a service that they don't get in terms of speed, and so on and so forth. But what was more revealing to me was the number of people who were willing, if I asked them to participate in a class action lawsuit, which in the only last year, the year before, was class action approved as a result of people like me pushing for that change. So I intend to use that information and try to mobilize people in defense of their rights. And I'm just giving you one example of the many ways in which one can mobilize people. And increasingly, you do so using Twitter, using the internet, using Facebook. And I think you just have to pick a cause. There are so many. You just need to walk out on the streets of Mexico and they confront you there in the face. Domestic abuse, poverty, women's rights. As my friend, the philanthropist and businessman Manuel Arango says, those who don't know what to do to change Mexico, well, start jumping on one foot and something will come to you. Yes. Back there, T.
Buenas noches, profesora. ¿Sí se escucha? Sí, profesora Denise. My name is Sofia Gonzalez. I'm an international student undergrad from Mexico City here at Berkeley. So I was wondering if you could maybe expand a little bit more on Peña Nieto's presidential campaign and his success. Mm. And I mean, it is true that he became a brand, but my question is...
He became a what?
A brand. Uh-huh. But my question is, Could it also be accounted to the fact that there is a strong historical unconsciousness from Mexican society, or also the fact that suddenly the drug war in Calderón's presidency had more weight than the 70-year-long dictatorship that the PRI had?
Well, I think there are multiplicity of factors that explain his success. One of them to cite Mario Vargas Llosa is that Mexico is a country of masochists. He said that if Mexicans brought the PRI back into office, it would prove that we were a country of masochists. But there's one important factor beyond the fact that he constructed a brand, that he hired the best publicist in Mexico, my dear friend Ana Olaguenaga, who we don't talk about these things when we have lunch. The fact that he spent, to this day, we do not know how much money Enrique Peña Nieto spent on his presidential campaign. But there's one important ingredient to remember here, and that is the National Action Party's incompetence. I frequently joke that I voted for Vicente Fox and I'm still in therapy. Think about the National Action Party's incompetence, about the 6 years of a wasted opportunity under Vicente Fox, about the 6 years in which the drug war became the central dominant narrative for Felipe Calderón, and how that was the measuring stick by which his administration was valued and judged. And of course, the valuation after 60,000 dead was extremely negative. And the fact that the National Action Party just didn't know how to govern. It didn't have a clear agenda for change. Vicente Fox, instead of taking on the alimañas, tepocatas, and víboras prietas that he talked about in his campaign, ended up cuddling next to them, as he did with El Bester Gordillo, or Felipe Calderón and El Bester Gordillo. I mean, we tend to place all of the responsibility for the dire state of the Mexican educational system on her shoulders. But the fact is that it takes two to tango, and she was dancing the tango with Carlos Salinas and Ernesto Zedillo and Vicente Fox and de cachetito with Felipe Calderón. So for Mexicans who wanted change, the National Action Party did not become the embodiment of that. And let's remember as well the failed presidential campaign of Josefina Vázquez Mota. And then let's place some blame also on the shoulders of the Mexican left that is in many ways responsible for the return of the PRI, because the left could and should have been the clear alternative for Mexico in 2006 and 2012. And what happened instead? We saw a left that succumbed to internal infighting, a left that to this day does not know what to do with Andrés Manuel López Obrador. A left that should have become a modernizing social democratic force, that should have moved to the center, that should have attended the concerns of a growing, albeit slowly, middle class. a left that instead paved the way for the return of the PRI, and it will have to live with those consequences. A left that is unraveling before our very eyes. And what a shame and what a tragedy that is. I'm told that there is no more time for questions, although I'd love, really love to stay here. So you'll just have to invite me back, Ali.
We very much look forward to inviting you back.